Hey gang, welcome back to our video series about how to really up-level your game in your Zoom presentations and really do stuff you can't even do in person. This is going to be the final video in that series. Today we're going to talk about presenting your material on Zoom and also group facilitation. Now, I think the slides and the multimedia stuff that you can do in Zoom is one of its killer features. And you can even read notes from a script or just bullets, and nobody even really knows. You just have to be careful about your eye line so it's not like off. Now, if you have two screens, this is absolutely a piece of cake. It's when you have one screen or a laptop that it can get tricky, because if you don't do it right, people will see your notes and they'll see your screen. So let's say this is your script. Maybe it's just bullets, or maybe it's a fully scripted dialogue. And these are your slides. Now, one pretty easy way is to just sort of disconnect this and make it its own second screen. And then you can go full screen here and present. So now you can see that this is full screen. I like to swipe over with four fingers. And now what happens is you can actually select just the screen that has your slides on it. And now we can tab through this in a very easy way. And you can't see my script, but it's pretty easy for me to tab back over and simply read my script. So I'm just tabbing between scripts and presentation, script and presentation. So, you know, put simply, you just have to make sure that when you share your screen, that you choose the correct screen to share. You don't want to share your entire screen. You want to share just the PDF or just the window that you're trying to share. Now, after you've done that correctly, all you have to do is toggle back and forth between the two, and it can actually be pretty simple after that. But warning, if you get this wrong, people will see your notes and it's really embarrassing. It's absolutely worth practicing with a partner or a spouse before you do it if you have any question whether you're doing it right or not. And while I'm talking about looking like an idiot, you know, clean off your desktop and close down all the apps and the other programs. You know, first impressions matter. So you don't want to look like a digital pack rat when people are seeing your screen. I once saw that one of my bosses had an illegal downloading program for movies. Wow, that doesn't send the right message. So just wrapping up section four, the multimedia tools are pretty easy. You just share your screen, and whether it's a slide presentation or an audio or even a video, you can share that. I really recommend that you have a lot of attention breaks. So maybe they're looking at your face for a while, and then when they get bored of that, you throw some slides or some video in there, right? When they get bored of that, come back to your face. You really want to make it flow and have a lot of visual variety. All right, section five. Let's talk about facilitating groups, discussions, and using the breakouts function. Now, group facilitation is just a key skill if you want to master Zoom. Now, done right, it makes people feel so impressed. I've had people write me and say, wow, that was the smoothest meeting I've ever been part of. But when you do it wrong, it feels like a melee. It feels like a mess. It's total chaos. Unless you feel bad or like controlling, you're not trying to control. You're really just creating the rules of the road. So people can disagree. They can disagree vehemently. You're just controlling the space and making sure that the space is a calm, functional space. Now in Zoom, the most important aspect of group facilitation is simply controlling the mic. Just like who gets to talk. Really, left to the wild, the audio in a Zoom room will just become absolute chaos. You've probably experienced this where everybody's talking. You want to imagine that there's one mic and you're the one who's passing it around to whoever needs to talk. Now, a really great way to do that is to get people to use the Zoom hand raise function. Now, what's great when they use this is it will cue them in the order that they raise their hand. So if you have five people who want to talk, it will put them in the order that they raise their hand first. Now, as I said before a million times, it's important that if people aren't talking, that you have muted them and you get to control that through the participants window. Now, keyboard shortcuts become really handy here. So Command Control M will mute everybody except for you. So watch out, you'll still be off mute. And Command Control U will unmute everybody. I'm not suggesting you memorize every single keyboard shortcut, but that one's really handy. Also, gang, feel free to get help from a co-host. I've been using this program for 5 years and I can barely do everything myself. There's a lot to do, muting people, throwing things up on the screen. It's okay if you need help. When you designate a co-host, they have functionally almost every capability that you have and they can help you. Let me show you how to do that. So as you can see, I've got two participants in my room right now. Simply go to the participants window, find that second person, and right next to their name, you'll see more, and you can simply say, make co-host. And then it asks you to confirm, and now that person is my co-host. Now, a co-host can be in charge of a lot of stuff. They can allow people into the meeting if you have a waiting room enabled. They can make sure everybody stays on mute. They can keep track of what's happening in the chat box. They can queue up questions for later. They can help you manage the breakout rooms and even bounce between breakout rooms to coach people and check in. And even the sort of tasks like making sure the meeting's being recorded and reaching out to people who are absent from the meeting and kicking people out even if they're breaking the rules. Okay, let's talk about the chat box for a second. I'm personally not a huge fan of the chat box. I know why it's necessary. And it's great for sharing files and dropping links into the group. But, you know, it comes with downsides. Namely, people start having side conversations, and those side conversations can undermine the main conversation. So there's three ways to be smart about using the chat box. Tip number one, just call it out ahead of time and just head off the bad behavior. That sounds a little something like this. Hey, gang. Let's try to keep the conversation in this main area. Please don't use the chat box for side conversations. Simple as that. Tip number two, give people permission to interrupt you. If they feel like they can't get a word in, they'll put it in the chat box. But if they know that they can just unmute themselves and say, hey, Demir, can you stop real quick? I've got a question. Then they'll do that. And tip number three, if you have a co-host, have them monitor it and sort of gently redirect people and say, hey, guys, let's not have side conversations. Let's ask that directly to Demir. Okay, now let's talk about the big boy. The big boy, the breakout rooms. This feature is so cool and so important. When you use it correctly, boy, it blows people away. The problem with large calls tends to be that people sort of get into a passive mode because they feel like they don't need to engage or that people aren't really listening to them. But if you do a breakout, even for 5 minutes, everybody gets to engage. And actually, a study from Google shows that the more that each person has an opportunity to engage in a group, the more they feel connected to that group and the better they consider that meeting having been. So I like to do breakouts even if I don't really need people to contribute, because I know that it engages them more and they will enjoy it if they even got one moment that they could open their mouth and contribute in some way. And of course, you can't do it in the main room, because if you have 30 people and they even share for 2 minutes, that's an hour. So a breakout room is a great way to send people off into groups of three or four or five and have them contribute without taking up too much time and sort of draining all the momentum out of your main meeting. Couple pro tips. I would use breakouts early in the meeting rather than later, because you'll notice this really sets the tone for people. It wakes them up and lets them know, oh, I'm going to have to contribute. So you'll notice they'll be more focused throughout the rest of the meeting. Okay, let me turn you on to a couple of use cases you might not have considered for breakout rooms. The first is a mixer, a social, almost like speed dating. You can form a group and then unform it and rapidly reform another group where people are randomly assigned. So if you've got a big group of people that doesn't know each other, you can give them an icebreaker topic, form a room for 3 minutes, break it out, form another room, break it out, form another room, and in 9 minutes, they can get to know a ton of people in this seemingly random assortment of people. It creates a sense of connection that you think you can't get online, but you actually can. An accountability check-in. When you have a lot of people in a room, it's hard to have each and every person do a check-in and say, here's what I said I was going to do. Did I do it or not? It's great to use the breakout for that function. Have everybody break out, hold each other accountable, and then come back. Brainstorming. It's a great opportunity to break out groups of 2 to 3, 4 people, have them brainstorm and bring their results back. Special topics. Maybe you have an engineering group and a design group, so you can have different breakouts for different topics. And even sidebars. Maybe the main group is talking about something, but you can have 2 or 3 people have a sidebar conversation, and when they're done, come rejoin the main group. Gang, there's a ton of great tutorials for creating and running breakout groups, so I'm just going to link something below. But this is something you really want to get good at, especially if you have bigger meetings, anything over 6 people. And pro tip, use your co-host to jump in between the rooms so that you guys can give as much attention as possible to each breakout room. Now, as much as I like breakout rooms, they can go bad in a couple ways. So let me give you a warning. Number one, set the rules of the road very clearly. Warn them against oversharing or abusive language or breaking through the time limits. You might even want to nominate somebody to lead and keep time. A really fun trick I use is I just say that the person whose first name comes first in alphabetical order is going to be the group leader. That means I don't have to assign somebody, but each group automatically knows who their leader is. So quick recap on section 5. Boy, breakout rooms are hot. They are so amazing. They do things you can't even do in person. So if you have groups over 6 people, you really want to learn how to use this. Okay, let me give some final thoughts for this whole series. And if you didn't see some of the videos in the series, go back and check them out. Gang, I would never go back to in-person meetings. Not if my life depended on it. Zoom is so much better. Online is so much better. And it's not rocket science. It's so easy to use these programs. If there's something you don't know, there's always a YouTube video that's going to show it to you. And I think Zoom is the leader because they make it so intuitive to use this program. Being able to work and live from anywhere I want, but still do badass presentations to sell high ticket, man, that makes your life so much better and it's worth it. And it's not just you, your audience has an experience that can't be replicated in person. So go ahead, embrace your inner showman, set up Zoom, learn how to use it, get great at it, and work and live from wherever you want in the world and blow your clients away. If you like this video, give me a thumbs up and maybe even subscribe if you want to see more videos about realizing your full potential. Bye, gang.